Welcome to Our World Today, a progressive political show imagining a better tomorrow. I'm Suzanne Linton, and my guests tonight for our show Solving Healthcare, we have Frederick Taylor, Dr. Frederick Taylor, and Papa John Kolstad comes back again. How nice of you to, and you brought Mr. Frederick, or Dr. Frederick.
Yes, that's essentially correct.
So thanks to Papa John, we have you as a guest to talk about that ever-continuing topic, not yet solved, the healthcare issue. Okay, Frederick Taylor, you are an adjunct professor of neurology at the University of Minnesota School of Medicine.
Correct.
Right, and you are a headache medicine specialist and a neurologist.
And a member of Physicians for a National Health Plan, Minnesota.
There we go, which is BNHP, which we will talk about, but that's it. Thank you very much. And Papa John, lifetime political activist. You're a businessman with Mill Street Music.
Mill City, excuse me.
And you're a musician. Probably equally all these three things. And a wonderful family man, but we won't go into all that. And friend. So, yeah, well, welcome both of you.
Thank you. Thanks
so,
for having me.
Oh, good. Well, thank my pleasure, my pleasure. Okay, so let's talk about what brought the two of you together and why you two are here tonight to talk about the, you know, solving healthcare.
So I'm a physician of about 30 years, and I have my own personal experience as a patient. I have, unfortunately, many too many patient experiences where healthcare has let them down. Those are two reasons for which I'm active in Physicians for a National Health Plan.
And how long have you been with them?
I've been with them, a decade and a half. But because I was extremely busy in a headache practice and running a dedicated headache, comprehensive headache center, I used the excuse that I was too busy to do other things, such as advocacy for patients and, frankly, all of us, whether we're patients now or only in the future, about how to change our healthcare system. So now I have an increased time opportunity to do this. I am the head of the business group within PNHP, and it is with this that I met John, who has educated me in a quick fashion. And
yes,
it's together
doing that.
With John and others that we hope to move forward in not only influencing the overall citizenry about how we need to further change healthcare, but business, how they can benefit in particular.
Yes. Okay. So you two have been working together.
I began with PNHP in 1992. My father-in-law was a physician, and we were going to study healthcare because I was a business. It's a big issue with business, especially small business. And I wanted to study it and know more about it. And I told my father-in-law that we were going to do this study circle on healthcare, on healthcare policy. And he said, I'm a member of PNHP. I'll bring over the information from them. And it turned out to be the best materials that we had gotten. It was just, they were excellent materials. And so that was my introduction to PNHP.
And that was how long ago?
It was in 1992 when that began. Ooh. So I've been working on this all that time.
Wow.
Through the years, I've been part of a couple of different organizations working on the healthcare issue. And recently, PNHP has formed a Minnesota chapter that's doing excellent work. They're very active. They want to solve this problem. And so they brought together people that are outside of being just physicians to bring different communities into this discussion, but focused in with PNHP. So that's what we're doing. We're on the business, yes, in the business group, and we want to talk to businesses about why this would be much better if we solve this problem and how to do it. We know what the solution is. We have very good legislation in the state of Minnesota of how to do this. There's national bills to do this. So we're just starting to talk to business people about that.
Great. Yes. So, but, hey, you guys, we have now Affordable Care Act that's going into effect. Why do we still need to think about problems with health care? Can you explain maybe what's good about Affordable Care Act, maybe why it's not quite enough, or?
Yeah, let's talk about some of the pros first.
Okay.
Although I don't think we should spend too much time because I think most people know them. It has, or will, begin to reduce the number of uninsured. It will reduce the risk of, possibly I should say, reduce the risk of bankruptcy with lifting lifetime caps, removing those. Make sure you help me out, John. We've got the 26-year-olds covered, and there's one other.
The pre-existing conditions.
Yeah, pre-existing conditions have been eliminated. And those are the biggest pros. There may be a hidden bonus for business that's predicted, but we'll have to see, and that's entrepreneurship. There's, I think, positives and negatives about the removal of job lock, as it's referred to, that you are tied to your job because you get insurance through it. And the removal of that may increase the number of people who go into sole proprietorships. Mm. It's estimated that it will jump. We pride ourselves as a country as being one of small business and sole proprietors, but it turns out that the Europeans, with all those universal healthcare systems, are far and away above us. We are the second lowest in the world of democratic countries for sole proprietors. So there's 34 others above us who have more people in sole proprietorships than we do. And in part, that's definitely healthcare related, mm-hmm. although I wouldn't pretend to say solely.
Mm-hmm. This is why it's so important for business people to understand that we can solve this healthcare problem. And especially, I've been a small business person. I've been with the Minnesota, there's an organization in the Twin Cities that does, that's exclusively small business, the Independent Business Alliance. And one of the things that we've realized is that small business is actually the biggest business in America. It's the biggest business in Minnesota. Nationally, it's over 50% of employment is with small business. And the last study done by the Minnesota House Research Service, which is a very good group, they do good research, they found that 90% of the new jobs come from small business. So this is a very important part, and it fits right in with exactly what you said. That's why Europe has done that, and that's why they've had less of a problem from this economic downturn recently. So it's a very powerful thing for the community, for economic development, and job creation, which is what we desperately need in the whole country right now. It's a big problem.
Now, what does the ACA not solve?
Yes.
Doesn't solve universal care. It doesn't solve the uninsured.
You mean everybody's not covered?
Then the estimates will be a minimum of 31 million remain uninsured. That is down from 55 million, but that's not even a 50% decrease.
200,000 in Minnesota will not be covered.
The problem there, 250,000 is the best estimate I've heard, but the ACA will create, while it reduces the uninsured, it will create a pool of what we're now calling the underinsured. Mm. And that has an official federal definition, which is if you pay more than 10% of your I think it's federal adjusted income, you are underinsured. And it turns out when you combine the uninsured, 31 million, underinsured, you have 46% of the population between 19 and 64, so we're not counting the Medicare group, 19 and 64, you've got 46% that will be uninsured or underinsured.
Oh my.
Again, underinsured is important because it means you're gonna forego getting your medicine filled because your insurance isn't quite good enough to give you the coverage you think you need. You're not gonna make that doctor appointment because you're not sure you need it. You are worried about it. And it may be something quite serious, but you're not quite sure.
And
so you're gonna forget it.
Tough
or you weren't quite sure the doctor really, really was ordering that test because you needed it, so you don't go get the test. Those are all the consequences of being underinsured.
Yes.
So there is more. We've just talked about insurance and underinsurance. It leaves investor-owned insurance companies running the business of the health system.
Yes, which
they are dictating
a big part
more
of
and more and more.
Yes.
And as just one example of that, the most recent figure of 2012, the top six CEOs from the healthcare industry is just one of the ways that money is siphoned off of what should go to care. They garnered $38,000 a day in income, whereas my understanding is the average individual is below $34,000 and the mean income in the U.S. for households is about $52,000. You have CEOs earning $38,000 a day, whereas these are per year figures. So that's just one of the siphons. You've got marketing efforts that, frankly, Medicare doesn't have, that a single payer program would not have. You have underwriting for denial of services as well as determining what group you get to go into. And there's just many factors that create an inefficient system where the estimates are about $400 billion a year is wasted by the insurance plans.
Now, as a physician, did you ever feel that, either you or your colleagues were interfered with in with the patient relationship that you had of what that you, as a doctor, thought should be done, but the insurance company was saying, no, you can't do that? I've heard stories of that, but what's your perspective on that?
Well, I can tell you, John, about a patient, because she's just a very good example of many. I'm a headache doctor. She had migraine. She came to me because I am a specialist in the field. I happened to be out of network for her care because her system didn't actually have a bona fide board-certified headache specialist in network. So that meant all her care was actually unpaid for by her insurance plan. Mm-hmm. They refused to cover anything. That led to a severe attack that produced a stroke. And because migraine can lead to stroke at increased risk, that led to a hospitalization, which they attempted to refuse, but ended up covering some of the costs. They shortened her rehab stay, which is averages about 28 days in this country, to 14. And refused to cover more, so she was discharged prematurely. And her out-of-pocket expenses were right around $20,000 when her personal income actually was less than that. Family income was about $50,000. And her husband has diabetes and hypertension and a few of his own diseases. So she was employed, had employer insurance, but was not adequate to cover her needs. And her needs weren't so extraordinary. She has migraine, which frankly, one in five women in her age group has. So it's a woman's health issue, and she was let down by our system. I have multiple examples where things are refused coverage. She, as I said, they would not cover the medication that she felt was the only one she responded to, which frankly, in my opinion, led to a stroke in the end because she could not adequately treat. I've had many cases where I've been told that I could prescribe this but not that, when the patient and I had had a very serious discussion about what was right for her, from my perspective and her perspective. So yes, there are interferences, and yet we have a very friendly health insurance group in Minnesota in general compared to many places in the country.
Yeah, I've heard that.
We do. I mean, they are generally more friendly to patient care than many places, and yet it's not uncommon to have many hoops that we have to jump through. It's estimated that the physician spends per physician about $80,000 a year to jump through the hoops that insurance companies require to get patients covered for what they and the patient have determined to be right for them. About $80,000 a year per physician.
And that cost goes back to...
Well, it always goes back to the patient somehow or another.
Yes.
To that charge master that more and more of us have heard about that goes up and up and causes people, especially without insurance, to really get billed astronomical fees for. Because the rest of us, lucky enough to have insurance, at least the charge master is marked down for us.
Yeah.
Well, we in business had a similar situation. As an employer, I had to select every year the plan. And they changed it every year. The offerings were different every year.
Yeah.
And of course, the price was always going up by about between 10 and 15% every year for my business. And so every year we had to go through this thick description of the policy and trying to figure out what in the world this said. And I read contracts. That's what I did with my company. I couldn't understand what my plan really covered. You could have some kind of an idea. There was the summary, and we'd eventually pick a plan. But most businesses spend about 40 hours a year just to pick out the plan if everything goes well. If you've got an employee that has a cancer incidence in that, then the entire plan of the business is affected by that, and the rates can go up astronomically. Now, I don't know how much that's been improved now with the ACA, but it's still private insurance, and I just don't think that problem is yet going to be solved. So,
well, if the rates go up, like in your small business, who pays the cost for that?
Well, that's a fun question, because business people think that they pay for health care, but unless the business loses money, that's a business expense. They just pass it on to their customers. And then my case, my customers were stores. So they in turn passed that cost on to their customers, the retail customers. So I'd realized that who's always paid for health care are people who buy any goods or services, or anybody who pays any taxes. Because the state provides and government provides health care at various levels to various groups and to employees and all that. And so our tax dollars are also paying for it. So anybody who pays any tax of any kind, or anybody who buys any goods or services in the United States, now who does that leave out? Not anybody. So if we're paying for it, why don't we just do it ourselves? We're paying for it anyway. And if we could save a lot of money, and we're going to talk about what single payer is, and why that would save a lot of money and provide better health care.
Yes.
Yeah. And one of the other things that crossed my mind as John was speaking was the sort of employee-employer relationship. And I have heard from a number of business people talk in the terms of that if I don't provide health care, I can pay my employee more, which reversing means if I provide them health care, I am reducing their salary.
Yes.
So not only are customers paying, we are really all paying, but even the employee is directly paying for health care. Even in cases of big companies where they may be spending $12,000 a year and the employee paying maybe $3,000 to $4,000, the average cost now being roughly $15,000 to have health insurance by somebody. The employer is withholding that from the employee, and of course doing what John has said. So it's, you know, it's a perplexing problem for sure, and more so for small business, which is why we're particularly getting active here. I mean, big business has their human resource department, and they've got people just paid to do that. But the smaller the business, the more we're expecting that person to be the owner, typically a healthcare administrator.
Somebody has 10,000 employees, they go to the insurance company and say, well, what kind of deal are you going to give me for 10,000 employees?
That's true.
Well, if I got 10 employees, I don't get the same deal. So it costs me disproportionately to do that. And me being representative of all small business people.
Yes.
Yeah, I've got some notes on how challenging it is, just to sort of make sure we covered it. Yeah, if you're going to be a good business and you want a good business reputation, it's stated from what I've read that you have to communicate with your employees because they also spread whether you're a good business or not. Mm-hmm. And now you've got even a more complex issue of communicating with one's employees and retirees about all the ACA aspects. You've got coverage benefit decisions, workforce hours, 30 plus, 30 minus, a whole new wrinkle in the issue, buying risk-based or self-insured plans, higher costs for better benefit employee benefits, but you've got ACA taxes that you have to think about, wellness program design, incentives and penalties, ensuring employee access, another issue because it is understood that we do not have sufficient primary care providers in the country yet. We're bringing more people in, a good thing, but will we get access? And the good employer is going to want to make sure his employees get that access. So there's another responsibility, even beyond, I think, the complexities that existed before. I understand there's IRS W-2 spending reports that go to the employee and IRS requirements that are new. And then there's the issue that I referred to, job law. The loss of that, can you retain your employee and remain competitive? And finally, I kind of referred to it as, do you keep your company reputation? I mean, those are all wrapped up into this. Seems to me, as a business person, you want to get rid of the healthcare responsibility altogether. Okay, and I hope it's not by just dumping insurance or employees or cutting hours, because there are ways to solve this without doing that.
Right. And, yes. And you'd mentioned the ACA, and I just want to repeat that the ACA is the Affordable Care Act, or sometimes called Obamacare, just so people, if they have any questions about what it is. But let's talk about how we can solve this. So let's talk about what a single payer is, and, which is what both Fred and I support, a single payer system, which is much more efficient, covers everybody. It's like Medicare, if you understand Medicare. It's like Medicare for all. Mm-hmm. And I am now on Medicare, and I will tell you, I love Medicare. And when I went on Social Security, there are people who complain about the government doesn't work well. I will tell you, they did a great job. Mm-hmm. It was easy. It was well done. I kind of wish it was my Social Security was a little bit more each month, but it's always there. It's a very good plan. So the universal single payer means that universal, everybody covered. Single payer means that we put all our money into a single place through the government generally, although there are plans like in Germany, it's done not through the government, it's done through
both.
Yeah, through private nonprofits. So you could do it that way.
Highly regulated, just to make sure. It's
highly
extremely regulated in Germany.
Very low profit margins.
Very limited number of companies. But so they do have a private sector in Germany, a large public sector. It's about 75% public, 25% private, but the private sector is highly regulated. That's an important distinction from some of the discussions going on here, in a sense, to deregulate healthcare.
Right. Mm-hmm. So with a single payer, we put all our money in a single place, and then the doctors, hospitals, clinics send their bill to one place. And in addition to what it does for the patients and for the doctors to spend their time on the issues of healthcare, it also reduces the staff for the hospitals and clinics. And they say in Canada, a hospital of the same size has a tenth of the staff people there as we have here, because they're all filling out all these forms and dealing with calling up there. Can we give them this? Can we give them penicillin or, you know, whatever they're doing? In Canada, the doctor makes the decision with the patient of what the treatment is to be.
Yeah.
And it's much better. I'd much rather have somebody who's been to medical school, who's had experience with all this, understands what drugs do, making the decision about what it is that I need in conjunction with me, than have somebody on the telephone at an insurance company somewhere who knows nothing about me or the relationship.
Right. Whose only motivation is let's save money and make more profit.
Yeah, an example of that, I think the quote is correct, attributed to Uwe Reinhardt, an economist who's associated with Duke University. Yeah. And he is quoted in a fashion of saying, the patient is understaffed regarding nurses. There's usually multiple patients per nurse, but there's one insurance evaluator adjuster per bed in the hospital. And
oh,
that's insanity.
Gosh.
You know. Yeah. Let me just make a few points about what universal single payer, as proposed, generally, are there variations that people have proposed different ways of doing this?
Yes. But I just want to get this clear. When we talk about the other 34 that are before us or better than us, like, for example, all around Europe and all the other industrialized nations that have health care, it's called single payer, pretty much, isn't it, in Europe? And
well,
aren't we describing?
It's a form or another of universal
care.
Okay.
There is socialized medicine, which we are not talking about.
Okay.
The United Kingdom and Sweden have forms of socialized medicine, which means it's publicly financed and publicly owned. Another term for owned is delivered. The providers are paid directly from the government. That's socialized medicine. No one in this country that I know of is talking about socialized medicine. We are talking about single payer, which is publicly financed, but delivered privately.
Yes. Oh, okay.
So that it's owned, in a sense, by the people. When you get into an ethical system, you have everybody included. You have public financing, but you have a few other things. You have clear accountability. You have public stewardship, and you have a budgeting process. It's those last three things that we kind of are lacking in our system right now. We don't have adequate stewardship. We do not have a budgeting process. And I don't think any of us feel that we've got adequate accountability. And once you get into a single payer system with a private delivery, you can actually figure out where all the money's going, who's delivering what, what provider is actually doing things excessively. Mm-hmm. Very easy to figure out. Very easy.
Okay. I want to cover a couple of points here that for universal single payer is that everybody's covered,
mm-hmm.
and we pay for it by our ability to pay, which means that if somebody makes a lot of money, they'd pay it more than somebody who makes almost no money. If you make mm-hmm. no money at all, you don't pay anything. You're still covered. So it's by ability to pay. It's comprehensive care. It covers everything. It's the Minnesota Health Plan, the John Marty's bill, is an incredibly comprehensive plan. It's amazing to read all the thinking that's gone into that. You have your choice of doctor.
So you're supportive of that, John Marty's
bill. I'm very supportive of that. You have choice of doctor, hospital, clinic with that. And it costs, collectively, it costs much less to deliver this. And the studies show that they in Canada and in Europe, where they have this, their outcomes are better. So we have poorer outcomes for the most expensive system in the world.
Oh, no.
It's not a good idea. We got to change it.
So the United Health Group owns the Lewin Group, as I understand it.
Yes.
And United Health is the biggest insurer in the country. And yet the Lewin Group, taking a look at the Minnesota Health Plan as written, showed that we would save about $4 billion in 2014 if we had this enacted. $4 billion as a state.
Billion.
And the average citizen.
Just Minnesota.
The average citizen would save about $1,250 a family is a family, and the employer would save about $1,250 about per employee.
Also.
So there is somebody who's going to pay more, and that's what scares people off. But the figure is 95% of people will save under single payer, will save. The top 5%, you could argue, and that's the
argument. No, we're talking about the very, very wealthy.
Wealthy on the top 5%.
And the top 5%. And
they
will pay, what are they thinking?
They will pay
about
more. Not all of them astronomical amounts. It will go up by being wealthier and wealthier. But 95% of people would save by this system.
Mm. Now, a lot of people think of this as being a liberal or a left kind of a proposal. That this is socialized medicine is a term that's often used in a pejorative manner, even though it's not true.
That's the propaganda that's out there about it.
Well, it's an argument. I'm not sure I'd characterize it as propaganda, but that's how some people think of it. But their characterization is just erroneous. That we actually do have socialized medicine in America. It's called the VA hospital, which does very good, by the way.
Yeah.
They provide very good health care. But I have a friend who is a business person. He was a Republican legislator for 17 years in Pennsylvania, and he has become a super strong and wonderful advocate for universal single payer, what we're talking about. And I had a discussion with him recently, and I said, you know, I'm considered more from the left side of the spectrum politically, at least socially, but I said, but I'm really a fiscal conservative. That's how I ran my business for a long time. You got to be careful. You can't take a lot of risk. You got to be able to pay for things. There are a lot of things as a small business, it makes you into a fiscal conservative. And that's the way I've always been. That's the way I ran my business. And mm-hmm. I said, so, you know, I'm really a conservative. I'm a fiscal conservative. Mm-hmm. And I'm talking to this Republican. And he said, well, you're right. This is the fiscally conservative thing to do because it costs less money for everybody. For business, but also for everybody. He said, but it's also the traditionally conservative thing to do, because if you take out the insurance companies and you just pay for this out there, then it puts competition back into the marketplace, so hospitals and clinics are going to have to compete again by performing really good services and being, you know, really good customer friendly, and do things in a really good way, and maybe by keeping the cost down too. So here is a Republican legislator, conservative, is a very strong advocate for universal single payer because he says it's the conservative thing and it's the right thing to do for business.
Thank you.
There is this belief that competition can be put into the system. I think that's part of what's behind a voucher program, that you will increase competition. But the falsehood there, at least from my point of view, and I think most's, is that would count on clear accountability and clear transparency in the system, and there isn't. If you go to any source to find out in your ability to get insurance, MinSure, I think MinSure is actually very well done. I've been on MinSure. Hmm. I've looked at the system. I'm actually going to buy through MinSure just because of my retirement from clinical practice, and it's stated to be simple, but it is not simple. As a provider practicing more than 30 years, I find it very complex to decide about which deductible I want and mm-hmm. what premium and what the heck coinsurance is. And in fact, it turns out there is a study that looks at the four major terms: deductible, copay, maximum out-of-pocket, and coinsurance. And as of the time of the study, only 14% of the populace could answer what each one of those was correctly. And
I couldn't.
Therefore, you can't really compare and get competition. You can't see the charge master, which is what are they going to bill you? You
yeah.
can't figure that out. Plus, nobody does it when they're in an emergency.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody. You go to either whom you know or the closest facility. That's how that works. It has nothing to do with who offers the lowest
exactly.
price. So There is even one more complexity. A study shows that when you compare two insurance plans that look identical, they have the same deductible, they have the same premiums, the same maximum out of pockets, the only possible way you're saved is to stay in network, which are becoming narrower and narrower and narrower, because if you do anything out of network by accident, the ambulance delivered you to a facility out of your network, you're going to pay for that. And you can't predetermine what the cost is going to be. If you're a diabetic, you might think you could figure out that this plan has got a cheaper total cost for diabetes than the other, but it turns out they may have the most expensive plan for having an MI. So if you could guess that you were going to have an MI from your diabetes, you might pick the other plan. In other words, you have to know what's going to happen to you health-wise, which you can't, in order to figure out what your costs are going to be in this system. In a single payer, you know your costs. Your costs are whatever your taxes are based on your ability to pay. There aren't any after that. You aren't going to make decisions based on that.
No matter what happens to you.
We're already paying taxes of one form or another, at least most of us are.
Yes.
You know, so.
You know, in the comparison to this kind of a program is to compare it to how our homes are covered for fire or for police protection, for that matter.
Yes.
That when you have smoke in your house and you're fearful of a fire or there are flames and you get on the phone and you get called, dial 911, and you say, my house is on fire.
Right.
They don't say, do you need a copay? Do you have a fire insurance?
Which plan have you got?
Which plan are you on, right?
Which is the first thing that happens when you walk in the doctor's door. Where's your insurance card?
That's right. And where's the copay? If that's part of it.
So
just to think about this, and so why do we have the police and fire do that kind of coverage?
Yes.
Because if you diddle around while you're looking, well, we have to check out your policy and we have to get the copay before we start putting out the fire. Well, the house is burned down and maybe the whole neighborhood could burn down because the fire will get out of control and become a mess. So we've decided publicly to have this policy that we're going to take care of the fire, we're going to make sure we have equipment ready, and we have a system in place so we can get there quickly, we can save lives, we can get people out of the building, and then get the fire out and try and save the building for what it is. So that's good public policy, and that's why we do this.
And we give our citizens the freedom to live close to the fire department or 100 miles away if that's what they want.
Yes.
We do give them that freedom, but
other than that,
they are otherwise going to be covered by fire and police. And
my friend in Pennsylvania opened one of his lectures, and he said, "Why do we have government?" It's a rhetorical question. It's a great question. Why do we have government? We have a lot of government. Government at every level, in every state, all over the United States, all over the world, we have government. So he said, "So what does government do? What's the purpose?" He said, "Government, we have it because it can do the things for us that we can't do individually for ourselves." And the fire department is a perfect example. The highways,
roads,
the water, all those things you think of. And so this is how we work collectively to provide services that we need. We never know which one of us is going to need it and when. We got to make sure it's there because we don't know when our house is going to catch on fire, if ever.
So John can correct me on this because this is something I've learned from John.
Okay, John,
and that is the argument about big government and small government, and the argument needs to be about good government and bad government.
Exactly.
There's no such thing as too big a good government, and nothing so bad, nothing small enough as a bad small government.
Right.
So I think that's part of the argument. We are the people make our government, not the government itself. So we just need to be very proactive. And one of the things that we need to be proactive about is continuing to change insurance. Mm-hmm. I wanted to just put in some very specific points about how business could benefit, just in case they haven't heard it, since it, to me, sounds like it may be, well, it's my employees, but how am I going to really benefit? Clearly, lower direct costs unless you don't insure your employees. immediate elimination of costs of almost all of administration. Eliminates healthcare negotiations from collective bargaining, a big sore point in most systems and most businesses. Predictable, transparent costs for budgeting right up front. Right? Reduces workers' compensation costs, legacy costs eliminated for healthcare. Equal ability to compete for employees in the job market. Reduces unfair competition to compete internationally. A healthier, happier, more productive workforce. Who couldn't want that? I think increased entrepreneurship. And then I have an 11th point. It's just the right and ethical thing to do.
It's the right and ethical thing to do.
You know, maybe we should go, we have a clip that you brought.
Oh,
maybe we
yes.
should go to that and get that in. This is a delightful clip. I saw this at the PNHP annual dinner. It's really fun.
Imagine a future with no healthcare bills. No confusing plans or restrictive networks. It'll be simple. One quality plan for all of us, for our whole lives. We'll be free to have the job we want, not just the job that provides insurance. We'll be free to see our own doctors and receive the best care for our families when we need it, not just when we can afford it. We won't have to put off seeing the doctor and risk getting sicker. We'll be free to have the care our doctors advise without worrying how we're going to pay. Freedom from financial worry. Freedom to be healthy. Join thousands of Minnesota physicians and patients who are working to make it happen. Help us. We can make this real, right here in Minnesota. Now.
Doesn't that just about
yes,
say it all?
Yes, that's great.
And so. It's a delightful little production.
Mm-hmm.
So it's fun.
You know, single payer can be put into sort of three categories. Simple, uniform. There's uniformity in the system, which doesn't exist now. And our system is definitely not simple. I don't think anyone from a business owner to the employee to just the average citizen finds anything simple about it. And there are savings. There are clearly savings. Gerald Friedman has looked at the national level plan offered by Conyers that has co-signees, including Keith Ellison,
yes.
McCollum recently co-signed, and our 8th district representative. I apologize that I can't think of name, but we have three Minnesotans in the House. I think that's it, who have co-signed this. But an analysis of that legislation has shown that we would save trillions of dollars by employing a single payer plan.
Let alone what it would do for people's lives, to take this fear and this burden off of their backs. And then the business people who would be relieved of that burden, who could start putting that effort into doing their business.
Well, we could take what is the most expensive system and yet a system that is mediocre in every other way. The Organization for Community Development, Opportunity Community Development, looking at industrialized countries, says that we're near last in every category. Mm-hmm. No matter what you look at, we're near last.
Yes.
And while we have improved in the last decade, the other countries have improved more, so that we've actually fallen down the ladder even further.
Mm-hmm.
We're in the roughly 30th out of 34 countries. There is no way we can say we are the best. Regarding access, it doesn't matter what you talk about. You talk about access. We are the worst at people filling their prescriptions, which the doctor has said you should take. Actually making a follow-up visit that is asked for to make sure that things are going well, to follow through with a test. We are about three times larger problem than Canada, which is often our comparison as the country we don't want to be like.
You know, right.
Half our costs, about third the access problems we have. Physicians actually moving to Canada while you hear stories about them moving here and patients coming here for care, it's actually patients going to Canada to get drugs,
exactly.
And more physicians moving that way than that. Mm-hmm. So there are facts, there are myths that are inaccurate. We have a mediocre system that is the most expensive anywhere, by far, 2 times to 2.5 times. Some of the countries, 1.5 at least, nearest our competitor.
I've got a question here. Well, it makes so much sense. And all the data's in, all the facts are in, that this is the best way and this is what makes sense. What's the obstacle then to get this in place? I mean, why don't we just rush right in and do it?
I can tell you my opinion of why it's not occurring. And from a business perspective, I think that there's much too much money in the political process that is influencing our elected officials to at least be confused about what the right thing to do, and are listening to the lobbyists from those benefiting from this current system. So there are very few people that are benefiting a great deal from this current system. Mm-hmm. The other thing
well,
is, I think
benefiting though, I would like
well,
that clear.
Well, the insurance executives, people have stock in the insurance companies. Some of the people in the drug industry are making a lot of money off the way that
it is estimated that the ACA will be a windfall for insurance companies,
yes,
in the long
the
run.
Thing.
Although they are trying to make the public think that they're suffering here under it, there are plenty of estimates of windfall profits up ahead.
And
right.
And one of the concerns.
Yeah. I have a simpler explanation
for good.
Things. I think change is just really difficult,
mm.
And they did get this ACA changed, and of course it's complained about being behind doors and whatnot. And maybe that's how it had to happen because of what John referred to as industry. But overall, none of us like change. We simply tend to stick with what we know. And for business owners, it's a big change to the ACA, and single payer sounds like another big change. But there are three reasons why it shouldn't be a barrier. We have the WHO. We have the best trained physicians in the world. Nobody argues that.
Nobody argues
that. We have the best hospitals. The princes and kings of other countries come to institutions here. We have the infrastructure for that. I also think, as a country with brilliant entrepreneurship, we have many minds that have not been put to the right task, and once we put them to the task, we can build the best single-payer system there ever was or will be. So that's the who, you know.
Yeah.
The what, well, we've got the spending. We're the highest spenders. We've got 18.2% of our GDP going to it. Canada spends 9.something% of their GDP. Some of the other countries are down. Japan is in the 6% range of GDP in their universal healthcare spending. And yet they've got a system where you can walk up to a kiosk as a patient, put in a card, ties you into your system where you can find out what the doctor said about you, what all your lab tests were, where you can schedule your next appointment, all in a kiosk that you walk up to. At 6% of GDP, so we've got plenty of that, we also know how to do it. We've been doing it. The military, the VA, the CDC, the NIH, Medicare,
the entire rest of the industrialized world
is a proof.
Now, the second part of that, my answer though, is that the other reason I think part of it is this political thing, and that there's some gridlock. The other thing is, I think that the people of Minnesota and business people in Minnesota do not know that there is a simple solution that works everywhere in the world. And so part of it is getting the information out, which is why
yes.
we formed the Minnesota Universal Healthcare Coalition in 2003 to get the word out to people. And one of the things we want to do now is to get the word out to business people
mm-hmm.
that we can solve this problem, take this off from your back, have better coverage, and you can concentrate on doing your business and do that better. So that's a win-win. So I agree with all of the things that Dr. Taylor said, but I think in addition to that, I think that we have to get the word out to people. So that's one of the things
mm-hmm.
that we're doing And this is to sort of come to help to wrap this all up, is that what we need to do is to find ways to get out and talk to people all over the state of Minnesota to tell them how and why this is going to solve the problem for us. It's not going to be perfect, because there's no perfect system. Every system is going to have some problems, but this is far, far superior to it. It will cut the cost way down, and it'll give us that access to our doctors, hospitals, and clinics that we really need. So if anybody out there who is ready to listen about this, you can contact us at the PNHPMN.org and say, hey, we want to have somebody come and do a presentation for us. And we can do that. We have, in Minnesota, we have one of the best universal single-payer bills in the United States.
Yeah, that's true.
I know, because we studied this when it was being written, that John Marty has a bill called the Minnesota Health Plan. It's an excellent plan. I mentioned before, it's totally comprehensive.
Yeah,
it's all paid for by the ability to pay, and this is really what we need. And that includes dental, because Dr. John Marty has found that there's so many people who have gotten medical complications because they had bad dental problems, they couldn't go to a dentist to get them fixed.
Well, so, and it covers maternity, which if you look at the current plans, many of them only partially cover maternity, believe it or not. It covers all mental health costs.
Do they cover the first 4.5 months or the second 4.5 months?
Well, some of them cover only co-insurances, which means you pay a percent of everything you do for maternity, which means some will not get maternal care. And it covers chemical dependency issues. Yes. So it covers all necessary care, is the way we say.
Yes.
Not unnecessary care. It covers necessary care. And another high note is, you know, Governor Dayton did sponsor a Citizen League forum that traveled around the state, mm-hmm. and people gave opinions, and it was, to my knowledge, it was fairly nonpartisan. 41% said, how do we have to solve this health care problem? And they answered it with single payer.
Yes.
Now, the public, as in all things in health care, probably needs more help, because 26% said universal care. And single payer, of course, is a type of universal care.
Yes. Yeah.
So who knows how many, but we just need to push that up, and we need to get those people active. We need to get 50 to 60%, as other movements have, that eventually win, so that we can say in the end, we were ignored, we were made fun of, we fought, now we've won. That's a Mahatma Gandhi statement.
I would like to send a challenge out to the business organizations that are possibly listening and watching this show, that it's very difficult to get into business organizations to the meetings. They have presentations all the time. I've tried to get into a number of them for years as a business person to talk about this issue. It's very, very difficult to get into those.
Oh.
They need to hear this. They don't have to accept it. I'm not going to tell them they have to believe what I'm telling them. But they need to listen and look at the information, because that's how I started. When I started doing this, I had no idea what a single payer was. I didn't know what, I knew none of this stuff. And I had to learn all of this. But after I'd gone through all of that, it was like, this is not only the best way, this is the only way to do this. So I send the challenge out there to the business community. Bring us there. Dr. Taylor and I'd love to come and talk about this.
Ah.
And you can ask all the hard questions you want.
Be
Bring
thrilled.
Up the questions. I would love to have them. So
yes.
Bring it on, right? Bring
it on
the challenge.
And the people in communities out
there,
churches,
both would go out.
Or other groups could bring people from PNHP. It could be us. There are a lot of other people who are very knowledgeable about this, who would be very pleased to come and talk with you about that and have a discussion. So a lot of opportunities here. We have a lot of expertise.
Great. And the way to reach you would be the website.
PNHPMN.org.
Okay.
The Minnesota, Physicians for National Health Program is what the PNHP stands for. There's a national organization, but this is the chapter in Minnesota that's really doing a great job.
And if you connect to that, they will connect to us.
Okay, good. Yep. Fantastic. Okay, we've got another couple minutes. Anything else you want to suggest?
Talk about the jobs part of this, because people are saying, oh, this is going to kill jobs. You hear that? And, you know, it's interesting, these statements that you hear in the media, they don't ever question them. They don't ever say, well, what do you mean by that?
Yeah.
How is it going to do that? They don't ever, they just say, oh, so-and-so said it's going to kill jobs. Well, and people hear that and they think, oh, it's going to kill jobs. I don't want to have this. If you look at a case where they went to single payer, Canada, and I have, there's a, was a study that was published in Business Week, or a real commie organization magazine, Business Week, and it was a study done in Canada 2 years after they had gone for the all of Canada to universal single payer. And the study was to see how this affected jobs and business. And they found out that in the 2 years afterwards, employment had improved by 2% all across Canada. It was lasting, it wasn't short term. Wages increased and business increased and profits for companies increased. In other words, everybody gained from
that.
Yes,
everybody won.
And the guy that did the article in Business Week was a guy named Chris Farrell, who, with those of no public Minnesota Public Radio, he did that business show on there for years on the morning, on the weekends, on the Money, I think was one of the names of the program. So it actually improves employment.
Mm-hmm.
And the John Marty bill also has, because there'll be a transition from the insurance, the system we have now, we'd have a transition over to the plan as we would like to see it. And there are going to be some people that are going to be what do they call that, dislocated from their jobs, but there are going to be so many other jobs created.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, a lot of the people working for the insurance companies are going to be needed now. I understand a lot of the people that you call, when you call the insurance company now, are nurses.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a nursing shortage. So it's like, this solves two problems.
Yeah.
And they can go back to work what they were trained to do, to work as nurses, which we need. So there are a lot of solutions.
Any more time? Always, something more.
How about 1 minute? Well, a minute or so.
Well, some people would say costs are going to go way up with this. You're underestimating costs from this system, and they will look to a lot of factors. And yet, one can say that there's no evidence that the costs we're already spending is due to patient visits, because we're far below office visits in this country compared to all the other European countries. There's data on this. Hospital days, we are the lowest in hospital days. That's partly managed care, I guess, is the way to put that quickly. All these other countries, though, with much cheaper costs, have many more days spent in the hospital than we do. Oh, how about those smokers? Why don't we make people responsible? It turns out that we have one of the lowest smoking rates. Only France is slightly smaller by Canada, 0.5%. France is almost double, and their expenses are cut, I think 5 times below ours. How about others? There's many ways. It's not MRIs. It's not.
Thank you. Thank you.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Yes.
Thank you,
John. Thank you, Fred.
We'd love to come and talk to people.
Yes. Thanks for doing this show. And everybody wants to learn more, go to the website. We're on. If you want to watch our shows, go to ourworldtodaytv.org.